After years of research, design, and testing, the Oceanbird concept is ready to begin challenging the way we think about international marine freight movement. When upwards of 80% of the world's goods are moving by sea, are we genuinely moving back towards sailing ships in this modern age? It's actually a very environmentally sensitive idea. Pushing your car half a mile would take a lot of effort. The same thing could be accomplished at a much greater speed with less than half a cup of gasoline. There is an immense amount of energy hidden in the chemical bonds of processed hydrocarbons, and we've learned to exploit that extremely well over the years. What we didn't know from the 1900s to 1960s was that there were serious problems associated with it that we wouldn't really begin to notice until the 1970s. Los Angeles residents suddenly woke up to the fact that they couldn't see all the way across their city in the valley because of the perpetual smog, and they figured out cars were to blame. Rule changes were imposed for the internal combustion engine cars, and in LA, they were so remarkably strict that the air taken in by an internal combustion engine actually came out of the exhaust pipe cleaner than when it entered. The cars were literally cleaning the air. Score one for the environmentalists. As a direct result, all internal combustion engine cars are much better now. However, it's not just chemical pollution that is the problem for ocean-going transport ships. The constant throb of these ships travels through the water for hundreds of miles. Measured at the ship, the sound level is in the area of 170 decibels, caused not just by the engines, but by the spinning propeller churning and cavitating the water. For a human in air, this level of sound energy could cause burst lungs or pulmonary contusions and embolisms. 170 decibels is like a rocket lifting off or a shotgun blast next to your ear, except constant. This is why NASA puts viewers several miles away from a launch site. Over time, a sustained 85 decibels can cause permanent hearing loss, as experienced by thousands of factory workers per year. Now, imagine being a dolphin, whale, or any other creature that uses sound to navigate, and how much damage this could do when there is nowhere to escape the blast of sound waves. Dolphin speeds top out at around 32 miles per hour because water cavitation from swimming faster causes pain and damage to their tails. They would have to travel at maximum speed for hours to get away from a noisy ship. Worse yet, all these aquatic creatures use sound to hunt for food and find mates. If they are deafened by the immense noise, they may not be able to eat or breed, and will then decline towards extinction. This is even more important than you think, since whales hold massive amounts of carbon in their bodies. When they die, they take it to the ocean floor, where it is sequestered. During their lifetimes, they poop, of course. And that supplies the ideal food for phytoplankton, which in turn produces 2/3 of every breath you take, much more than the rainforests of the world. Killing off the phytoplankton destroys the very base of the global food chain. Is it possible that noise pollution damage to these giant sea creatures is the reason that they run aground and beach themselves? Are they trying to escape the painfully loud noise near human shipping? Or are they so damaged from constant high-level noise as to be navigationally blind? It seems certain that this is true, and the cause is apparently not so mysterious after all. Right now, virtually all freight traveling the world's oceans is still propelled by fossil fuels burned with wild abandon, because other choices are limited. Container ships traveling from Asia to Europe carry millions of gallons of fuel oil for every single trip. They are responsible for 3% of the world's CO2 emissions, 9% of sulfur oxide emissions, and up to 30% of all nitrous oxide emissions. The CMA CGN Benjamin Franklin is the largest container ship docking in North America and usually carries 4.5 million gallons of fuel. This is equivalent in volume to more than 236 of those 40-foot shipping containers sitting on its deck. If those shipping containers were actually filled with diesel fuel, the ship could empty 3.5 of them or more per day to run its engines on a trip lasting 14 days in each direction. They would therefore burn nearly 1.8 million gallons of diesel fuel for that 28-day round trip. At designed cruising speeds, these massive freighters can consume 63,000 gallons of fuel per day. With fuel prices skyrocketing, they have reduced speeds significantly to save as much as 33% of their fuel costs. Of course, they need to add more ships to the routes to meet the shipping schedule. Apparently, the savings seem to be worth it. But what if we could completely do away with fossil fuels for propulsion? In 2018, the International Maritime Organization required a 50% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions for their 171 participating member countries by the year 2050. There are several strategies to achieve this. Some ships use rotating vertical cylinders for generating the Magnus effect to achieve additional propulsion. This is similar to the Bernoulli principle for aircraft wings. When the wind encounters the fast spinning cylinders, air passing on one side is accelerated while wind on the opposite side is slowed. The net effect is increased thrust due to lift expressed sideways rather than upwards. Fuel savings can be from 5 to 20% by exploiting this energy gathering technique. Others are flying automatic kites up to 200 meters above the ship. The stronger winds at that level help increase efficiency and reduce pollution by 20%. Fully automated, a captain pushes the on-off switch when the navigation computer detects ideal wind conditions and it self-launches or stows as needed. Oceanbird is a Swedish ship that can carry massive amounts of RoRo, roll-on, roll-off cargo, at speeds approaching current freighters. This is particularly true now that conventional freighters have slowed down to cut fuel costs. A fossil-fueled RoRo freighter, previously taking 7 days at normal speed, would outpace Oceanbird by 5 days. But now, they're heading towards similar figures as conventional vessels try to economize on expensive diesel fuel. Oceanbird has rigid sails, made of metal and composites, each standing 20 meters tall. They can extend telescopically to nearly 80 meters in order to take advantage of the stronger, steadier winds at that height, or retract to deal with severe weather conditions. Added to the height of the deck above the waterline, the sails will reach a height of 105 meters, making this the tallest of any ship on the oceans. For efficiency, sails are computer controlled and automatically trimmed to take the best advantage of the wind. A big advantage of the design is the retractability of the sails. Bringing them down makes most harbors in the world easily accessible to them, slipping easily under most bridges. Of course, they will still have thruster and maneuvering motors for docking, movement in harbors, and avoiding an unpredictable problem on the high seas. The majority of the propulsion will come from the wind. Each of the 5 sails can freely rotate 360 degrees without interfering with any of the others. Oceanbird's functionality peaks in a crosswind rather than from directly behind. With a tailwind, the rearward sail collects most of the energy, leaving little for the forward sails to do. But even a slightly angled wind can push on all the sails, generating much more power. Theoretically, as they advance the design, Oceanbird thinks it can achieve a 90% reduction in fossil fuel use and emissions of pollutants. They can sustain 11 miles per hour, according to the current design, slower than fossil-fueled vessels, but they found that shippers are quite interested. The much lower impact of the vessel will help improve their public image and lead to positive feedback. Adapting to a slower delivery schedule is simple enough once established. 2 such vessels at 11 miles per hour could deliver 7,000 cars and trucks each in less time than 1 big diesel ship carrying only 8,000 could in 2 trips at 17 miles per hour. And largely eliminating the fuel budget makes it significantly cheaper. Using little to no fuel for propulsion, but only to power necessary electrics, electronics, lighting, and facilities, means that the ship is essentially silent. Eliminating this particular impingement on sea life could mean the recovery of the North Atlantic right whale population, which currently stands at just 366. It could mean the recovery of many sea populations that have been the victims of the acoustic fog that currently blankets our oceans. During a prolonged period of ocean quiet due to COVID-19, researchers found that whale song, long-distance communication, was increasing in subtlety to levels seen decades ago. They expect it to fade again as shipping resumes its usual levels and communication becomes more difficult. We've already done the easy thing for decades. Now it is time to do the right thing and get off the fossil fuel bandwagon. Using the sea to move is great, but destroying the sea to move is foolish. Let's enjoy the silence of the wind. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to check out our video on the genius plan to clean our oceans. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.